So Lord Monckton, you asked us a question on the radio show the other day about a sphere and a cylinder. You want to repeat the question and perhaps finally give us an answer to that conundrum?
All right, it was a little tease. The question was, a cylindrical hole exactly 1 meter long is drilled right through the center of a sphere. What is the volume remaining in the sphere? Now, the answer to the question can be approached in two ways, as I explained on the program. First, by logic, which is the quickest way, and second, by mathematics, to confirm the logic. Now, I won't do the mathematics for you today because it's a little bit long, but I can do the logic for you. The interesting thing about the question is the information that you are not given. You're not told what is the diameter of the sphere. You're not told what is the diameter of the cylindrical hole. All you're told is the cylindrical hole passes right through from one side to the other.
And that it's a meter long.
The sphere. Mm-hmm. And that it has a length
of a meter.
Of 1 meter. Mm-hmm. So, the next thing that one would do, having identified that the information hasn't been given, is to understand that provided that the questioner is acting in good faith, the information hasn't been given because it isn't necessary. If it isn't necessary, you then have to look at what are the limiting cases. Now, clearly, there's no upper limit to the size of the sphere or of the hole. As the sphere gets bigger, obviously, the hole will get bigger too, because you've got to keep it only at 1 meter in height. So in the end, you end up with a cylindrical disc, rather like a coin, if you like, going right out with a tiny, tiny strip of, let us say, planet Earth around the edge of it, and all the rest would have been carved out with the two spherical caps plus the cylindrical depth of 1 meter and the other sort of spherical cap at the bottom, leaving just that very thin wafer of Earth. So then you go to the other or lower limiting case, and the lower limiting case obviously is that since the hole is 1 meter long, then the sphere through which it is being drilled cannot be less than 1 meter in diameter. That kind of follows,
correct,
doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So, since you're told what you are told, that it is a 1 meter hole, you can legitimately infer that the answer to the question is that the volume remaining in the sphere, however big the sphere, and however small it is, as long as it's not smaller than one meter, is of course equivalent to the volume of a sphere 1 meter in diameter. And that's all you need to know to get the answer. That's the value of being able to use logic as well as mathematics. Logic gets you there often in a much quicker way than sometimes mathematics can. And then what you can then do is use mathematics to study the area of the volume of the spherical caps, the volume of the cylinder, the volume of the sphere. You can do sums, you can check it for spheres of different sizes, you can eventually apply the necessary calculus to establish that this will always be the case, and check that the answer is right. But the answer you can get, as I did when I was first asked that question, simply by logic.
It seems to me that kind of a question can differentiate between the actions of a computer and the actions of a human mind.
That's the point. One of the things that a human can do is find shortcuts that the computer may not have been programmed to understand.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are limits to the intelligence of a machine, but there are no limits to the intelligence of a human properly and diligently and artfully applied.
Well, I don't know what that says about Bob and I, but we didn't come up with the correct answer.
Well, we came up with two different answers that were very close. I thought my answer was, I just assumed the sphere was a meter in size, period. And I said, well, if you put a cylinder in it, it's still going to be the same volume.
But you hadn't quite thought it through.
I never thought, because I thought you were placing that limitation on it.
There was no statement about the diameter of the sphere at all.
I assumed it went through from one side to the other. Now, Robert came up with another idea that I thought also made sense, too.
I was thinking of the relationship and that, first of all, if you're going to ask such a question, there must be an answer for it for all cases.
Yes, correct.
Because you did not give us the dimensions, right, the width of the cylinder, nor the diameter of the sphere. Mm. So I got the idea that it had to be, of course, an all-case type of scenario.
So and between you, you had the right answer, which makes you a good team.
Two heads are as good as yours. Thank you, Lord Monckton.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. A pleasure.